as another day draws to a close in the capital, the nighttime world of London's wholesale food markets is beginning to stir. Between them, these London institutions have been supplying the city with fish, meat, and fruit and vegetables for centuries, and are a rich seam in London's history. But how relevant are they today? And what will their role be in the London of tomorrow? Smithfield, Britain's biggest and oldest wholesale meat market, is the last of the Corporation of London's food markets still trading on its original site. Once the location of London's livestock market in the 12th century, it began trading in meat when this building was completed nearly 150 years ago. For decades, it went unchallenged as the sole supplier of wholesale meat and poultry to the capital. And with this monopoly, it could afford to play by its own rules.
Ain't the same as it was years ago. If someone had to go at one of us, then you had to go at 2,000 of us. Could we all sit together? It's murder. If you ever come down the market to cause trouble, then you're in the wrong place. Yeah.
The customer service, although it's there, it's, you know, the political correctness isn't as strong here as it would be like in an office, really. Like, you know, we're lucky in that sense.
Today, the market's 42 businesses and 500 employees have to come to terms with a new world. Supermarkets and increasingly the catering and butcher trade now buy their meat direct from abattoirs, so Smithfield's dominance is in decline. And with the country in the grip of recession, it now needs its customers more than ever.
56.
But for some, it's hard to change the habits of a lifetime.
A kilo.
What is it?
One that's rolled up.
Look, darling, boneless already for the oven.
They're boneless?
Boneless.
How is it not? I don't want that one. Is it
not? Well, I'm not giving you that.
It's not like that, is it?
No, of course not. That was like that. That was like that.
Norman and Steve are salesmen for Warman and Guttridge, and between them have clocked up over 60 years' service on the market.
I want it on the pork.
I don't think I'm about to have it.
You want a pork loin? A pork loin.
I'm sure you say she don't want it like that.
Mixed with fat.
With a bit of fat?
Yeah. Because I always buy it.
You're always best to come on a Saturday.
Saturday?
Yeah.
Is it open on Saturday?
No.
So why am I?
Do it all right.
Yeah, I think so.
You sure?
I'm not sure.
I've been digging it out for you.
I'm not sure.
You're not sure?
I think I buy it in Sainsbury.
Pardon?
I buy it in Sainsbury or Tesco. I'm not sure.
Oh, okay.
It's the rudeness of some people. When you have a busy day, and you're right under it, there's no manners. Suddenly like clicking their fingers again, tapping the window. Like Africans, for example. But that, it's not rude, it's not deemed rude to them. They'll just come up and go, how much? Like that. it's not the way to get served in this shop.
It's mid-November, and the nightly deliveries have arrived, bringing nearly 400 tonnes of produce to Smithfield from all corners of the globe. Beef from Argentina, Africa, Argyll and Derbyshire. Lamb from New Zealand, Yorkshire and Devon. Pork from Belgium, Spain and all around Britain. Selling over the counter to members of the public and trading from the back of the shops with butchers, caterers, hotels and restaurants, Smithfield Market turns over around £750 million a year. Greg Lawrence joined the market as a trainee salesman in 1969 and has since become one of Smithfield's most successful businessmen.
We serve caterers, restaurants, butcher shops, anyone who buys meat, from the top level down to the pub on the corner. Daily basis, we'll cut 300 pigs, 500 lambs, beef. We try to fill the premises up every night, try to put volume through. It's a low margin, low percentage on profit.
Unlike the supermarkets, whose meat is largely cut and packaged at the abattoirs, Smithfield still has a team of skilled meat cutters working at the back of the shops. John, better known as Biffo, has been butchering pigs for the last 37 years.
There's not a lot of skilled men on the market now. There's only about 20, 30 men on the market now.
The technique of the truly skilled cutter has hardly changed, having been handed down from man to man, from decade to decade.
My grandfather was down here when he first opened up. When they had to queue up for a job. They used to queue for a job. Then my father worked down here. And, you know, it's like family. Years ago, it was a closed shop. If you never knew anyone, you never got in the market. This is called an hand and belly. I'll take it off now. They have to be a certain size for the chops. We go four bones up, which is this. This is the neck end. That's the neck end. And this is your loin. This is the hand and belly. You've taken it off, come with a joint, and that's off. That's your belly, and that's where you get your spare rib chops from. Now, if you have barbecue, you want spare rib chops. That's where you get that from. These is your neck end. And then he's left you with the loin, which you get all your chops off of. Then you get your pork chops. Then it comes to your leg.
So everything gets used on the...
Yep. Towels, trotters.
What do people do with those?
Three of these are a yard of meat. 3 feet. It's a good life down here. All laugh and joke and whatever. I mean, Paul's been up here as long as me. To see the changes up here, you wouldn't believe it, would you, Paul? No. Ain't the same market as it was years ago. I mean, I come up there one day, opened my locker up and all my clothes was gone. They left me an African war suit. The blue, green, you name the colour. So I put it on my home in it. Because once you're bit up here, that was your lot. If they could get the better of you up here, they'd slaughter you.
Biffo's been a shop steward in the union for over 30 years. In Smithfield's heyday from the 1950s to the 80s, the union ruled the market, protecting the 2,000 men who worked there and who each had their own specific job title.
On the lorry, you should have what they call puller backs. The puller backs, to pull the meat off, put it onto the pitcher's backs, and they would pitch it into the shops. That was the idea of pitchers. They're called pitchers. And they just put it on all the hooks. That's when it was rank union up here. I mean, the governors never had a say in it. They run the market. Any governor upset them, they won't put no meat in the shop. They'll pitch everyone else's meat in, they won't pitch your meat in. We used to have, like, could be 150 pigs in the shop. They had to be chopped down. But then there was 8 of us in the shop. And you have three or four cutters. Then you have what they call humpers. As you cut the meat, they hump it onto the scale. You have a scalesman that would weigh the meat over. That was a job on its own. They never moved from behind a scale.
Finally, the purchased meat was delivered to waiting vans by self-employed porters, otherwise known as bummeries. But when the market was forced to modernise to meet EU regulations in the mid-90s, most of these roles became defunct, and the union's power diminished, along with its members. Many of the old guard still mourn the loss of the golden age of Smithfield.
They paid all the pitchers and pullerbacks £20,000 to leave the market, and that was the end of the union. That was it. But the big change, because years ago was a laugh, Bobby. It used to be absolute a laugh a minute.
But for Biffo's boss, John, there was nothing funny about the union's dominance of the market.
A lot of people on Smithfield 20 or 30 years ago didn't consider they worked for the company. They almost felt as if they worked for the union. And, thankfully those days are gone now.
With the modernisation of the market, the 21st century is bringing new faces and new ways to Smithfield, whether it likes it or not. that J.F. Edwards, single mother Dee, is the first woman ever to take the 2 till 8 a.m. shift amongst the meat cutters at the back.
How long have you been working down here, Dee?
6 months, yeah.
How did you end up at the market?
I was a housewife. I was a stay-at-home mum for nearly 10 years. And I literally couldn't find any... No one would employ me. And I know John, our manager, and he said, if you want to come down and try it, you're quite happy to do so, and I've been here ever since. The amount of men's a bit daunting, first of all, really, but they're all quite nice, really. Very nice boss. He's very fair. They're all okay. How do I do here, Ken? Am I okay? Have you had women here before? No.
We've had a few salesmen.
Yeah.
But nothing on the backside. Yeah, right. Not on the actual physical side of it.
Yeah.
You're the first. As far as I know, you're the first.
Yeah.
They don't like early mornings. They don't like handling bloody stuff. And, it's heavy work. It can get heavy, so. And then I think it was probably in the olden days, it was a men-only domain.
Yeah, there would never have been a woman here. I'd have been sold as a wife, wouldn't I?
Sold as slaves.
Do you think people would be turning in their graves?
I would think so, yeah.
You stop that right now.
I bet you're what?
I bet you really could wait to do that, could you? My actual female friends are just, they think I'm quite inspiring for doing it. They're like that, well done. Everyone I tell what I do is like that, oh. They're a little bit shocked. Then they go, well, good for you. It's a good thing. It's girl power, I suppose, isn't it? It's all that kind of stuff, really. Yeah. I don't really mind the shift because I'm awake all day long. So I can do the housework, see the kids, cook the dinners. It actually suits me.
So when do you sleep?
7 or 8 o'clock tomorrow night. Yeah. For 4.5 hours. I get 25 hours sleep a week. Come Friday, I'm like that. I can't go anywhere, I can't do anything because I'm just falling asleep all over the place. But it doesn't really bother me because I'm working. That's the main thing, putting food on the table. I've got 2 children to support, yeah.
Is your idea to stay here and kind of try and build a bit of a career?
Yeah, well, I wouldn't mind getting out the front of the shops and selling stuff, yeah. Dealing with the customers.
And is there a chance that that can happen?
Not too sure, who knows. I'm the only woman down here. It'd be a big thing for them because everyone else is a man. Excuse me, is a man. So I don't know. I mean, I'd hope so, but it's so institutionalised, really. I'm not too sure. I'd like to say yes, but you never know, do you? You could be the one thing that holds me back, I suppose.
Breaking into sales will certainly be a challenge for Dee. As well as selling to those outside the market, some of the toughest negotiations are between the traders themselves, who buy and sell to each other so they can meet their customers' orders. Warman and Guttridge has a market monopoly on mince production, and for Norman, negotiating price with the other traders can test relationships to their limit.
Because you're £5 a kilo. I've told you yesterday, you don't get it at 4.40.
Got it at 4.40 yesterday.
Well, who served you?
Andy bought
it. Who's Andy?
My Andy came up.
Well, tell him I'll have to go. Who served you? If you ain't paying £4.40 the best mints, it's as easy as that. £5 a kilo. I'll tell you what, you fucking moron. What do you mean? What are you doing? You want to get trapped? Get trapped, you. Don't fucking joke.
Come on. Just
look. Don't fucking... Right. You fuck off. No. Just fuck
I'm
off.
I'm going up that way.
Sometimes things get to you as sad as they don't.
He wants best mints for silly money. It's not the point of... It's just a principle of it. We don't sell best mints at under £5 a kilo. He's telling me he paid £4.40 for it. He was adamant, so that's what he got for his sauce. I don't think I'll serve him again. I might have lost him. Not that I'm too worried about it. So.
Norman's boss is Mark, who took the business over from his dad a few years back after his ambitions to become a golf pro failed to take off. But establishing himself as part of a new generation with new ideas for Smithfield, has been far from plain sailing.
When I first started out, Norm would never give me the time of day, not at all. But to be fair to him, you know, I didn't know anything. You kind of have to be here a little while and to know how you work and to kind of build the respect to these guys that have been down there 40 years to kind of, you know, earn their respect. Do you know what I mean? It's not like you can just come in here and just, after 10 minutes, everyone's going, oh, well, you're the boss, you know. It's, I suppose it's like any job to a certain degree. If you're the new man, and especially if you're the boss's son, then you've got to kind of get their respect, really.
Three shops down from Mark, at James Burden's stand, new shop boy Anthony is trying to find his place in the hidden twilight world of Smithfield. His boss Jason believes he's worthy to join the ranks and is planning an initiation ceremony that's as old as the market itself.
He's been with us 3 months, works in a man's market. And because it's quite a close market, as you can well imagine, and we all work closely with each other, we've seen the same people day in, day out. And yeah, you form some good friendships, because it is an obscure place to work, as most markets are. And for a new kid, young kid as well, it's quite daunting. As long as he takes it like a man, people will equally respect him for that. Everyone's been gearing themselves up with various rotten product, eggs and blood and off, all bagged up, ready to go.
Smells lovely, too, yeah. Just need him to come out and we're going to get him.
Mate, that is cold.
It's happened for decades. I've done myself many years ago, no sympathy here.
You get people that I didn't even know, can't you, and say, oh, well done for that, you took that really well. You start becoming part of their little family, I suppose. It's nice to feel like this is like a little home.
And what about the rest of your life? What about your friends who work at normal hours?
Well, it's a bit hard to sort of stay in contact, because obviously they're working days, I'm working nights. I've got friends here now, so it's no big loss, I suppose.
There are other new faces entering the traditional world of Smithfield and adapting to its peculiar ways. At 2:30 in the morning, 6 miles away in North London, Mark, otherwise known as Marky Markets, sets out on his hunt for the best cuts of meat at the best possible prices. Don't you know each class? With his pioneering use of social media, Mark is a personal shopper for trendy Londoners who like the idea of fresh market meat, but not the unsociable shopping hours. Find your fortune
fine. You get hold of me on Twitter, email, phone me up, tell me what you want, and I go and buy it to order for you at the market.
Armed with the skills his 25 years in advertising taught him about promoting a new business, Mark traded in his daylight career for the nocturnal world of the market.
It's a completely different world. No one else is up around it. Well, there's clubbers and, you know, that sort of thing. But even though they're up at the same time, they're on opposite sides of the street, literally and metaphorically. They see through each other, those drinkers and the butchers. They never mix. So, yes, the Smithfield world, well, it's this whole new world. It's really exciting.
Do you want to go to now?
Nah, I've got it already.
Have you got your bavette?
Yes. Just a 2 kilo bag of that, please.
Small bag, yeah?
Yeah. Got a cup of 24 pounds, yes? Thank you.
A kilo of that as well.
A kilo?
Just a kilo, yeah.
A bit of bread or something,
not about women. It was quite scary going down the first time. You feel you have to earn your place in the market.
Pork mince, £14 a bag, darling.
It's a bit odd the way that you feel a bit happier than really warrants it when you get a nod or a hello off a butcher in the morning. You think, oh, I've arrived, I've just got a nod off a butcher.
See you later.
Just give us the smallest shoulder neck end you've got. And then a neck end boned out.
I do get better prices. When I happen to be standing next to somebody who orders the same as me, I realise that I've been offered a better price. So that's quite nice.
I forgot before, I need a kilo of sirloin, please. I know. I've not had any coffee, though.
You've got a great big book there, and you still don't have
it. It was right at the end in little writing.
Do it like a phone up there, my big writing, yeah?
Yes, Dad.
What sort of markup are you able to make?
Generally, about 30%, I think. I make sure that I can stay competitive, really.
Right, do you want to check your list, see if there's anything else?
Nothing else.
You sure?
Definitely.
You're supposed to be a fucking referee.
So macho down there. It's all, yeah. Just, yeah, big old baldy-headed guys. They've got knives. They've got knives and chainmail gloves. They're big fellas. They've got a very closed shop. They, you know, they all know each other. They all work day in, day out with each night in, night out with each other. And they never really see many other people outside that small closed world of Smithfield. And so it becomes, I don't mean it derogatorily, but it seems like a bit of a playground mentality. You know, you can see there's gangs, you know. There is so little influence of women down there. Well, women down there, but you notice them because there are so few.
Hiya, is the ticket in there for me?
My mum made me promise to shave.
Thanks. See you later.
Of the half dozen women working on the market, almost all are cocooned in porter cabins, working as cashiers. Jo's been sat in hers for the last 3 years.
Once I actually got in my little cabin and I was safe, I loved it from the word go. But you have still got to be a woman up here. You've still got to have that respect. And as I say, about 98%, they show me respect as a woman up here. And that's important to me. You know, I don't want to be treated like one of the blokes. But the banter's good. I like the banter. Loads of innuendo. But again, you have to stay one step ahead of it. And they know that they don't break the line. They know how far to go with the innuendo. And they tend to stick to it. They know the rules. So, and you lay them down very, very firmly.
How do you do that?
If it's inappropriate, you tell them. If they cut it out, that's enough.
Dee's duties, meanwhile, have been extended to include washing down the display cabinets at the front of the shop, which is bringing her into contact with more of the men on the market.
What's in my next picture, then? Did you really take that just really? You look beautiful.
You've got to keep as good as you get, huh?
Yeah, down here you do, definitely. One of them, the other man that was just showing me the pictures was him in a pair of red sequined pants and a Santa hat. And that's what the picture was. The other day he has one of him in a sombrero and not much else.
There you go, mate. All right. Thanks a lot.
With the night fast turning to day, Mark, like Smithfield's other customers, is in a rush to get away before the 7 a.m. congestion charge kicks in and adds £10 to his costs. For Stephen Norman, the charge is yet another blow to the changing fortunes of the market.
That's about it. Our congestion charge is hitting in, isn't it? Off we go.
7 o'clock. Party's over. You should stand here at 10 o'clock. People still coming by. 10 o'clock. As soon as that come in, about 5-6 years ago now, went straight out the window. That's that Ken Livingston for you. Brains of a rocking horse, boy. Unbelievable. Thank you.
I use the tube with my trolley, freezer blocks and chiller boxes, and deliver it as soon as I can to people's offices. Excuse me. Sorry. Of course, there are some overs because there are minimum amounts I have to buy. And so if there's any spare, that's when I get on Twitter and really use social media and sell the overs down at my Soho office.
Santa baby, just slip a sable under the tree for me.
In the week before Christmas, the market is pulling in the punters, much to the relief of the traders, who need to make enough money now to cover the lean months of January and February.
You think there's people buying it for a year? You can't move out here. It's like it every year. But there's no money about in the country. They keep telling us.
What do you think when you see people buying all that much money?
I just laugh.
Do you think they need it or are they just buying it?
Nah, they just, I don't know. I think half it's just greed, isn't it?
For Biffo's boss, John, the hoards are a reminder of the market's glory days, before its fortunes began to change, along with the changing face of London.
Going back to when I started in 66, it was a whole different scenario up here. I mean, the market was an absolute hive of activity. I mean, 10 o'clock in the morning, you couldn't move. There'd be barrows and people and lorries and vehicles. The place was a real hive of activity. But everything changes. The supermarkets, for instance, they don't trade with us now. I mean, back in 66, everything came through Smithfield Market. Certainly in the southeast, in the home counties, every stick of meat, every ounce of meat went through Smithfield Market. And obviously the supermarkets are much, much bigger now than they were in 66.
Santa honey. Do you like Christmas?
No, I don't. Ever since my mum died, I've got no interest in it, really. It's just for the kids, isn't it? Hey.
When did she die?
Mum died. 75 she died. My brother got killed when he was 14. On a motorbike. But he just lost interest, didn't he? You know, he just... Your mum's your best mate, isn't she, when you think about it? That's a good life, it'd be 2 seconds. She scared me, you'll never learn, will you? I said, no. I was always in trouble. I always get in fights and whatever.
When you first started here, were you still that way? Were you still angry?
No, when I started here, I was known as a steward with a black eye. It wasn't my left eye, it was my right eye. That's why I got my name, Biffo. All the kids used to laugh. Here he comes. See what he's got wrong today. Not saying I won them all. Won a few, lost a few.
Have you mellowed out a bit now?
Yeah. I got to now, I'm only 21.
With the hectic Christmas rush soon to be over, most of the traders are looking forward to a restful 4-day break over the holidays.
We are officially opening new Christmas Eve, but I can tell you now, both of my companies won't be open. If we haven't made it by Friday, I'm not going to drag people here on Christmas Eve on a Saturday. Forget it. I'll leave that to one or two of our other more cold and hungry traders.
The annual Christmas Eve auction is yet another Smithfield tradition, originally created to shift stock that might otherwise languish over the holidays. It's a bargain hunter's bonanza, while at the same time generating a tidy profit for Greg Lawrence, the only Smithfield trader open for business on Christmas Eve.
Have the money ready. There's no change on these. There's no change. These are whole rumps. You cannot beat the value. One price only. Get ready. £20. One here. Listen. One here. One here. One at a time. It's on this hand here. One at a time. One! Only one! I can only have one at a time! Yeah.
Come on!
For that man. One price, only £20 a bird.
Well, we're just buying for about four families and about six chest freezers. Meat for a year.
Yeah.
So we won't have to go to the butchers again for a year. And we're here every year.
Every Christmas.
Yes. It's a slick operation now. We've got buyers, we've got some carriers, and we're guarding the meat.
Do you use the market otherwise?
No, not personally, no.
Do you think we don't. Need to? Do you really think we need to use the meat market otherwise? We don't buy meat in the year.
£20! Come here quick, got to take the angry bird. What a deal. One. £20. Take it.
A seasoned market man, Greg's perfected the mix of showmanship and innovative sales technique that keeps the money pouring in.
If you win the toss, you get that for nothing.
Nothing!
Nothing. If you win the toss. If you lose the toss, you've got to give me 20 quid. Who wants the bet? Well, here we go. Who's first? Well, that gentleman there. Ready? Now, look, this gentleman's the witness on the call. Ready? Here we go.
Towns!
Give him a load of pull. That man there is the next man there. But here we go. Heads or tails? Heads, what is this up? Tails! Give me 23.
It's been very good, because it's been an excellent Christmas. There's nothing better than taking the money. You've got to keep taking the money. Our motto is keep taking the money. If they're ready, they want to buy goods, we've got the goods for them. You must keep taking the money, because we're suffering January or February, because it's the quiet period. I think 2012 and 2013 will be a very, very difficult. Very difficult. I think people will be more cautious in spending. I think they'll be more, not only cautious, more wiser in spending, and we're going to be in for a very, very difficult time. I really do.
As the new year commences, the refrigerators at Smithfield are in need of replenishing, and Greg Lawrence has placed an order for 320 of Devon's finest lambs.
Right, the lambs came in during the course of the evening. We've killed 480 this morning. We kill about 250 an hour, so they're all dead by 9 o'clock. Put in the chiller. Later on this morning, they'll be selected for various customers and loaded tomorrow morning and dispatched to Smithfield on Sunday night.
Peter owns West Devon Meats, an abattoir that's been supplying beef and lamb to Smithfield for over 30 years.
This lamb here is an ideal, the grade is a U3L, and that is an ideal lamb for butchers or wholesalers. Weighs 19 kilos, you can see how rounded it is. And it's just got the nice covering fat on it. There's one there that is a bad conformation. In other words, it hasn't got the shape there, there's two there. It hasn't got the shape. There's no roundness in the legs. And that's in the breeding. We will pay less for them and I will sell them for less money as well.
With the season for new spring lamb just around the corner, the profit in year-old lamb, or hoggets, is slim.
At the moment, we would be paying £4 a kilo for it, and we wouldn't be making much more than £4 a kilo for it either. So we're reliant on the skinless, which is our profit margin.
So you make no profit from the carcass?
No. Not at this precise moment.
That seems incredible.
Yeah, it is. Unfortunately, that's the way the trade is at the moment. The offal's sold separately, the liver, the heart. And of course, we've got your runner, which is sold as for sausage skins. That's all sold separately.
And what kind of money can you make for that?
That's my business.
As someone who's been supplying meat to Smithfield for the past three decades, Peter is well placed to see what its future may hold.
I think they're under threat with where they're situated to start with. Smithfield Market has always traditionally been in the middle of London,
But I think as time goes on, then they need to relocate to the outskirts of London for accessibility, not just for myself, but for the customers to get in there. Be much better situated in an outside area, whether it be Kent, Surrey, Sussex or whatever, with accessibility for large vehicles to get to.
These are lambs that's coming from Devon, West Devon Abattoir. These are good lambs. Perfect lambs, perfect shape. The price finds its level. It's all to do with supply and demand. Legs of lamb, for example, could start off this morning at 550 a kilo, and within an hour they could reach 650 a kilo. It all depends on the demand, and you get the feel of it. It's just like any other market.
Though a relative newcomer compared to Greg, Mark from Warman and Guttridge has been quick to learn how the meat trade works.
Everyone's got their own sort of margin that they work to. To a certain degree, but it really depends on what you've bought and what you can sell. Like some of the really expensive stuff, you don't make hardly anything on. You know, you're lucky to get 5%, you know, if you're lucky. On, you know, some of the more valuable stuff, like the fillets, and some of the old strip loins, the ribeyes, that sort of thing. But obviously, where the country's in like a recession, and it does make a bit of a difference, people haven't got the money, so we've noticed this year that the margins are obviously lower because you've still got to sell the stuff. To get it away, you've got to drop your margin a little bit, you know?
Apart from dealing with a squeeze on profit margins, the Smithfield traders are now also facing the prospect of a hike in rent in keeping with other central London properties. As far as Mark's concerned, it might be time to consider joining the city's fish and fruit and veg markets that have already moved to the outskirts.
I think we'll move to a different venue. You know, we're in the centre of London, there's great big arctics lurking about, and it's not an easy place to get in and out of.
And what would become of this amazing building and all the history?
They'd make it into little shops, wouldn't they? Little boutique type shops, I'm sure. Rent it out for a fortune, and because the property's worth a fortune, isn't it? You know, let's not kid ourselves, it's worth, you know, big, big money. They don't. The City of London probably don't want us here, to a certain degree. I wouldn't have thought they would want us here. Making all this rubbish, making all this mess, making all this, you know, all this, they'd want it to be, so it's not so busy, I'm thinking.
So you wouldn't be sad to go?
Personally, no. I'm sure some people would be, but no, because I could see the benefits of moving somewhere that would benefit our company.
But for others on the market, any strides to improve on the original Smithfield have been backwards ones. Steve Thompson, a beef cutter at Central Meats, has spent his whole working life in the London meat trade.
If you could have seen Smithfield before they developed it or made it into what it is now, it was a much, much better market.
Why do you think that?
Oh, it was much easier to work. It was all open. And don't quote me on this, but I think the new market was designed by a woman, and it shows, because she has not got a clue.
Why do you say that?
Because it isn't built for what we do. I mean, it's completely different from what it was years ago, but it's still a unique place as such. Eventually, this place will go, and it will never be replaced. I don't think they'll be able to duplicate this sort of environment, you know? And hopefully they won't get a woman to design it this time. They'll design it properly.
Despite all the talk of change, Smithfield's been the one thing that has remained constant in Norman's life, and it's something he'll find hard to give up.
This is not like a job. It's just a way of life. Always been that way.
How long have you been a Smithfield man, then?
May 61. 51 years this May. Used to be a shop in there, that tobacconist is there. Used to have an head shop, just used heads. Calf heads, lamb heads. And I said, any jobs? Got the job. Walked in this shop. All it was heads, heads all over the floor. Just heads. All had the air on, all full of blood and maggots and everything, you name it, it was there. Anyway, I picked one up, but I didn't want to touch it. Just didn't want to touch it. Being I was only 16, so you have 2 years over this up an apprenticeship. By the time you're 18, you're all big enough to carry the carcasses around.
Are you going to be here for a long time more?
Well, he don't want me to go, the governor.
Whenever. It's not a problem. He can do whatever he, you know. He's been with me for goodness knows how many years. I'll never force it upon himself. If he said to me one day, Mark, look, I just want to cut back, no problem. If you want to stop it altogether, not a problem.
I'm 67. Thursday. This Thursday, 1st of March.
Happy birthday.
But, still, I ain't going to be here forever, but while I'm fit and I'm healthy, it's just, you know, I'm pleased for it. I'm pleased to come here with the lads and have a chuckle. Not physically hard or nothing. While I'm still fit, and can do it. Do the job for him. Helps him out. Helps everyone out. I'd only get bored indoors anyway.
It's a funny old job sometimes, isn't it? You get these people that just can't leave. They're just, you know, they're sort of like working all the time. You know, Norman, a little while ago, his wife passed away. And I think sometimes he comes up here just to see all his mates, really.
Companionship?
Yeah, yeah.
62 she was, brain tumour. Just out of the blue. Couple of weeks, it was all over. There you go.
Must have been a terrible shock.
Yeah, I was, yeah.
And how was it facing in here? It must have been...
That's all right. Get over it, don't you? Life goes on, as they say.
Distract yourself with it.
Yeah, yeah. So it's no good sitting around moping, is it? Nothing's going to change. Miss Cara.
You miss her?
Oh, yeah. Must go.
After a life devoted to Smithfield, leaving it for a daylight existence can be daunting. With 42 years under his belt as a Smithfield man, Terry, one of Greg Lawrence's salesmen, is on the cusp of retirement.
It's a funny thing when you're going to retire. Oh, it's a bit scary. When I'm not here, I miss it. And when I'm here, I think, what the hell am I doing here this time of morning?
Mungo.
Started off as an umpire. I used to ump all the meat about. Then I became a cutter. Then I was a salesman for about a year. And then I had a chance of owning business here. We had four shops. And unfortunately, I think about 17 years, and I end up, we call it getting knocked. I got knocked for a lot of money, and yeah, a hell of a lot. And I just didn't want to carry on no more. And so we shut them, parted, and I come with Greg. Now it comes to the time when you can have it easy. I play golf, like gardening, but I don't know. I think I'll miss it after 2 years, but.
Is your wife looking forward to having you back on normal hours again?
I think so.
Who's the best looking here?
While Norman and Terry have clocked up nearly a century's service to Smithfield between them, it seems the next market generation is lacking that staying power.
If you get a kid of 17 or 18 who's willing to learn, I'm quite willing to teach him. But, you know, if you get someone coming and just wants to piss around or whatever, then he's wasting my time.
And is that the problem? They don't really want to learn?
No, they're not interested. They want to earn a quick buck outside, or what they want to want. You've seen them. As long as they get some shit up the nose or a bit of the old wacky back, they're happy.
At the start of a new week, the position, once occupied by J.F. Edwards' only female cutting room employee, is once again being advertised by her manager, Ken.
Is Dee around, Ken?
She's not, sir. She's gone. She left us yesterday.
What? Can you tell me what happened?
I think it was a pressure of things happening at home, as well as market life. I don't think the two go together.
What do you mean?
Well, you're working silly hours, you're working from 2 o'clock in the morning. So you're about when the kids are not, and then the kids are at home and you're not, so it makes it very, very awkward. And I think there's a few things that have been happening, and she got stressed out and she just thought that was it.
But for Dee, it was more than just the night shift that began to take its toll on her.
I just expected it to stop after I'd proved that I could do the job, I was quite competent. I thought that it would just slowly sort of eel off, and it didn't really. Yeah.
What sort of things?
One of them made me a bone in the shape of a penis. One of them showed me a video of his penis. One of them asked me if I'd like to go upstairs and have sex with him. Would I like to have an affair? I had all sorts of stupid little people touching me on my hip inappropriately, asking me inappropriate questions all the time. And these were supposed to be people that I liaised with, because they don't only work for our company. They didn't only work for the company that I worked for. They worked for other companies. And I was just supposed to just, okay then, sort of just take it. But after a little while, I think you find it a bit demeaning, really.
At Smithfield Market, unfortunately. Which is probably why there's not so many women. Dee was the only one that I knew that was working on the actual shop floor. You get a few of the cashiers that are female, but they're inside their little boxes, so they probably don't come face to face with it. I mean, I can imagine Dee going in whatever shop we went in was getting the same thing from all the blokes. I'll give Dee her, she should have ran, and she gave them a bit back, which is the way you've got to be. There was a couple of comments that really upset her. And I went and had a word with one of our directors, and he went and had a word with the guy involved. Said it didn't mean anything by the comments. I won't say what the comment was. But he went and apologised to her and said that it was no hard feelings. He didn't mean her to take it personally. It was a bit of manner.
Well, I don't suppose I minded it for a little bit because I thought that it would stop, but it didn't stop. Yes. Yeah. And I used to say to them, how would you feel if this was your wife? And they'd all go, I wouldn't want her working here. I wouldn't like what is being said to you, being said to my wife. When you actually look at it, right, when you're there and actually when you think about what goes on down there, when you sort of take a back step about what actually happens there, it's they are a bit Neanderthal, they're a bit backwards. It's almost like being in a Victorian market slightly. They could have transported the people really quickly and really easily, wouldn't they? Just add hoo hoo onto a few things and we're back. There's some straw on the floor. It wouldn't take much, I don't think.
Let's see, what fucking James Hunt you are.
Fucking asked you, beef or lamb, you eat lamb.
What?
Tell me when they've had that conversation.
Lamb head, you're not lamb head.
Yeah, I'm give your fucking cow heads, am I? I'm being drunk, on his house.
It's a funny place to work. It's not like working anywhere else because you wouldn't get your human resources and stuff. People wouldn't get away with working. They wouldn't get away with talking to clients the way that they do as well. That kind of stuff, I think, is a little bit, not disturbing, I think it's shocking the first time you hear them.
But opposite Dee's old workplace, Ian, working the front counter at Central Meat, has a different view to her when it comes to customer relations at Smithfield.
You deal with customers here, and because of what they know the way you are, you can. I can be as rude as I want, or if someone upsets you, you can tell them where to go. Basically, if you try that in any other place or walk of life, you know, it's one of the things where it's shunned upon.
Like Ian, Steve Thompson believes that anyone familiar with the market understands it's an oasis from the PC world outside.
People that come onto Smithfield Market, they should know what they're going to get. They know what they're going to get. We have a lot of banter out there with the customers, and invariably they have a laugh and a joke with us. You get the odd one or two that take it the wrong way. A couple of times we've been accused of being racist. Because most of our customers, like the Muslims and the ethnics, we have a bit of banter with them, but it's not meant in a horrible racist way. It's meant as a joke, something to break the ice on it, when they come in to see you.
She's coming back to you, mate.
Right, Steve, I'll grab a stack of each, yeah?
Yeah, I'll see you taking over, mate.
I don't worry about other people anyway, to tell you the truth. I speak to people as I like to be speaking to myself, otherwise I'll have a word. Might be ignorant to people because they're foreigners, but if please and thank you, it's easy to say. And I will tell them and all, to work with the public's hard work anyway. It is hard work, it's not easy. Can't be complacent, that it's no good. You can't keep fucking, I don't know, having a go at people. You just tell them what you think and...
Smithfield has a dull kind of...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's no airs and graces down here. What you see is what you get. Don't like it, fuck all.
1 kilo? You don't do ones, do you? £5 a kilo.
Sell them in pairs, sweetheart. £11. Now shut up, you fat cunt.
My money is £10.
Well, that's £11.
Don't do me a favour.
I'll do you a favour. Yeah. I'll cut them up for free, has it? Talk to me, darling. Yeah? You found another pound of you? Funny that, isn't it, eh? £11, sweetheart.
That is
yeah, can it be done?
Why I'm run away, cut it for me.
I will cut it for you. Boxers, a few years ago they had to give it away. It shows £5 a kilo now. The population in London now is a lot more mixed. A lot of the Africans, everyone else, they will eat oxtails. It's part of their culture. So obviously the more customers you have of the origin, the more oxtails you sell.
And is that who you're selling to, for the most part?
The majority, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's very rare you serve an Englishman an oxtail. But, obviously, I'm more to oxtails than anything else on the front there.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's part of that. As I say, it's just a reflection on the population of London there.
As a business owner, Steve's boss, Mark, is well aware of how London's changed and the value of its ethnic communities to Smithfield.
If we didn't have them, there wouldn't be no market. Especially all the lamb boys, they really require all the Turkish people to do for the breasts and the shoulders, and that's a great trade for them. You know, we still sell loads of stuff to the Asian customers, oxtails and all that sort of stuff that they sell to, you know, everyone else. So really, you know, it is a big trade. It is a big trade. We need everyone. Not just, you know, you couldn't say, oh, I'm not serving this group of people because the market needs everyone.
By early spring, Terry has finally hung up his Smithfield whites for good. But his wife Val has her own worries about becoming reacquainted with the man she's hardly seen for much of their married life.
He'll miss the market, but will the market miss him? I doubt it.
Really?
There's always, life goes on, there's always another face to arrive down there.
That's a little sad, isn't it?
It is, but that is, perhaps I'm being realistic, I don't know, but that's how I see it.
I mean, it'll be interesting for the both of you to sort of have all this newfound time on your hands to be together.
That's what's going to be difficult.
You've been ships in the night for a lot of your married life.
Oh, yeah. Not a lot, really. You know, like, all my married life. She used to say to me, go and go to your second home, you know, which it was.
They're stuck in a time warp down there, a lot of them. They've not moved on with the times.
What about...
But there's not going to be a lot of people who's going to like what I've just said, but that's how I see it.
What about women or...?
Yeah, it's a very male-dominated environment and... It sticks, you know, when you've been down there a long while, it does stick. They're very opinionated in a lot of things and what Terry's come home and said, and this is where we have disagreed on a lot of things. Because I think there are a lot of all old... It's a different era of how they are nowadays, you know, totally. And I think there's a lot of them down there that are very... got a lot of old-fashioned ways.
I mean, the market is nothing to what it used to be. I think it will definitely move, and I think they'll have the fish market, fruit market, flower market, and I think they'll have more than one. Those who survive it will become very wealthy people. For me, it's like a little, it's an era, it's come to an end. The atmosphere's gone. I mean, if you ask anyone, Dan, they must say it to you. The atmosphere is gone. I don't care who says that. You know, you used to be able to see the people in the shop next to you when you was cutting, because the bar was up and you see, you know, they would talk to them. Now, it's not in a factory or a depot. You know, unless you're outside, you don't see no one. And if you're stuck on that block in the back there for, I don't know, 6 hours, you don't see no one. You know, it's not the same life. Well, for me, it's not put it that way. You know, it's no difference to me anyway. I don't want to be there no more.
In the wee small hours of the morning, while the whole
good morning
world
how are you?
Is fast asleep.
Cool.
I love the market, it's my life. I've been up here 35 years though. I've just been into like it.
Do you think you missed out on anything?
No. I mean, look, the only thing is if you're a young fella like me, I just got married or whatever, it ain't the type of job that you want, because you're going to have problems with your wife or whatever, because the hours ain't going to adapt to a lot of them. I mean, some of these young boys come in here 9 and 10 o'clock at night. And you've got a young wife indoors who wants... They don't want to be sitting on their own all night, do they? You know, they've just got married, and there have been so many marriages break up up here, they're over it. But it's a job, you know. What do? You either want the money and the work, or you don't.
Does it affect your relationships over the years?
I've been divorced twice. You know, I've got no regrets. I mean, I'm not... just one of the things that happens up here, you know, life goes on. It's something you can't explain. Unless you work all your life, you can't explain the way you work up here. It's entirely different to anywhere else. This is just a one-off gaff for you.
Though its future on this site may be uncertain, for many at Smithfield, there's more to the market than simply bricks, mortar, and butcher's blocks. There's also its spirit and the glories of its history. But for others, this focus on the past could be a stumbling block to the market's place in the London of tomorrow.
Well, it does need to change. What they do to get over that, I'm not too sure. Start selling other products, probably. Be a bit more nicer to your customers. Open during the day. There are things that they could do, that they could implement really easily to change things, but I don't know if they're really ready for all of those changes. They're always saying, oh, it's really changed down here. I think they preferred it when it was a bit more archaic.
As how we buy and sell food changes, what might the markets of tomorrow be like? Listen to the experts and share your views. Go to bbc.co.uk/London Markets and follow links to the Open University.
Michael Wood continues his brand new series telling the great British story on BBC HD at 9 o'clock tomorrow night. And coming up next this evening, there's drama with Case Histories.